In France, the time from March 1793 to July 1794 was known as the Reign of Terror, as extremists like Robespierre attempted to seize and maintain control of the revolution. They used denunciations and summary trials, and they staged frequent public humiliations and executions to remind the public of the price of opposition. As a means of influencing public opinion, the terror was crude but immensely effective. And it is from this memorable and grisly era that we get our word terrorism.
French Parisians went about their business today after police announced that they had found still another bomb, this time in police headquarters. This is the latest in a series of bombings and attempted bombings by a terrorist group that has demanded that French authorities release a prisoner who is being investigated in connection with the murder of an American diplomat.
Hello, I'm Jim Hartz. Paris in the 1980s reminded some people of Paris in the 1790s. But one important difference is that Robespierre didn't have television. He and his allies had to stage their live events steadily, and they couldn't stage them only in Paris. They had to activate the Reign of Terror all over France because things that happened far away didn't seem real to people in those days. Both the objectives and the tactics of today's terrorism are different, but the Reign of Terror and modern terrorism are similar in their use of violence or the threat of violence to influence the public in a way that advances their cause. Lenin, the Bolshevik revolutionary leader, had a famous saying, kill one, educate a thousand. With today's media, a single terrorist action can be seen in homes throughout the Western world by dinner time the same day. So today we could update Lenin's dictum and say, one bomb educates millions. This is one of America's most respected newspapers. You don't see big ads on the front page, but political candidates and business organizations work hard to get their stories right here. If you're doing press relations for somebody, there are certain things that you try to achieve for your employer by getting into the news. Showing up on television or newspapers seems to confer a kind of importance on people, regardless of the reason for the report. Even bad news can be good. If someone accuses you of something or criticizes your position, your position gains recognition, and that can be better than being unknown. So, how do you get into the news? Well, if you're legitimate, the standard thing is to issue a news release. It has to announce something that's news, like the opening of a hotel or the launching of a satellite. It can be a report on a speech by the issuing organization's president. Another way to get into the news is stage an event. If you're a new hotel and you have a gala grand opening with celebrities and searchlights, the TV cameras will be there. When the circus marches elephants down the street, they get a lot of free publicity. If you're an organization that has a difficult time getting public recognition for its agenda, you can conduct a protest march. We have a long tradition in this country of publicly demonstrating our objections to things. The U.S. Constitution protects this right. Protest becomes terrorism when violence or the threat of violence is used to influence opinion. But if it's so easy to get your case before the public, who needs to resort to terrorism? What if you don't have enough people on your side to stage a public event to get media attention? What if you're arguing that the legal system, the democratic process, is a fraud? If you believe the system is controlled by your enemies, or if you believe that the news media are purposely denying coverage to your concerns, what if your objective is to force the government to break its own laws by releasing prisoners who have been convicted of breaking widely accepted laws? What if your objective is to show that the government is weak or incompetent and that it's unable to protect its citizens or enforce its laws? And what if your aim is to erode public respect for established authority? What if, with little diplomatic, economic, or military standing, you want to influence a large country far away to change its policy or its position? Those are the objectives that terrorism serves. Those theoretical objectives translate into specific and shocking actions. Let's look at some concrete examples. The United Freedom Front in New York bombs a corporation's building. Then they issue a press release. Before the bombing, a press release about capitalist exploitation of the proletariat or the crimes of imperialist America would have been discarded as the publication of the lunatic fringe. But after the bombing, of course, the press will be eager for any information about the little-known group. The bomb is cheaper than an ad the size of an article, and now more people will read it. We have homegrown terrorists in the United States who are seeking radical changes in our system and who work inside the United States. In the U.S., we have seen the Weather Underground, a violence-prone offshoot of the student radical movement of the 1960s. There is the Black Liberation Army, which points to American society's most obvious and painful problem, the length of time it is taking to achieve racial equality, and uses this to justify an attack on democracy and capitalism. Left-wing groups often claim to identify themselves with minority groups and to be dedicated to correcting historic injustices. At the other extreme, right-wing fanatics often act out of a belief that our government persecutes the majority. Groups like the Ku Klux Klan, CSA, Posse Comitatus, Aryan Nation, and so forth tend to identify racial or religious minorities as the cause of any national misfortune or as the major threat to our way of life. For more than 100 years, the Klan has been associated with anti-black violence. Historically, they've played on the fears of poor white rural people. In recent years, newer right-wing groups like the Posse Comitatus or the CSA have been using the farm population's economic plight as an issue in recruiting rural people to these organizations and in securing support. These groups tend to rely on a feeling that the government is under the influence of some hostile group, that there is a conspiracy against the real America, which they believe they are defending. They tend to be enthusiastic about building up arsenals and have had several violent confrontations with federal authorities. In Europe, most recent terrorist activity has been by left-wing groups. In West Germany, the Red Army faction is a descendant of an earlier terrorist group, the Bader-Meinhof gang. The RAF opposes capitalism, NATO, and the U.S. presence in Germany. Their most active period was in 1977, when they kidnapped a German industrialist, Hans Martin Schleyer. They demanded the release of 11 prisoners, some of whom were locked up for murdering a U.S. serviceman. The German government did not release the prisoners. In the meantime, a Lufthansa flight was hijacked by a Lebanese group claiming ties with the RAF kidnappers. In Mogadishu, Somalia, German commandos carried out a successful raid on the plane. They overpowered the hijackers, and the passengers were released. In Germany, the terrorist response was to murder Schleyer, the remaining hostage. In the face of the collapsing position, the terrorist in prison attempted suicide, and three of them succeeded. It's a small group. Some of their most important members are in jail, so they kidnap a prominent capitalist and demand the release of their comrades. They're trying to influence their own government, one of the most stable of the Western democracies, to release criminals who have been convicted under due process of law. In Northern Ireland, the Provisional Irish Republican Army advocates the withdrawal of British authority from predominantly Protestant Northern Ireland and unification with the predominantly Catholic Irish Republic. Even though the PIRA identifies with the Irish Republic and attacks British forces, its concerns and most of its support are local, and its people are local. It has sought financial support and arms abroad, but its agenda is a local one, based on the nationalist aspirations of the Catholic minority of Northern Ireland. The PIRA provides a good illustration of how a terrorist organization works. They execute complicated attacks of the sort that require substantial resources and good organization, and they've survived determined police efforts to put them out of business. You find a very small group that we call the hardcore leadership at the top of any terrorist organization. Next down, you find the active cadre, the trainers, the people who do the shooting, the bombing, the kidnapping, and so forth. The people in this layer don't necessarily know many other people in their own layer, and they rarely know the people in the layer above. If someone gets caught, the organization is safer if the captive doesn't know very many of its people. The active support group forms the next section of the pyramid. This group includes people who offer overt, publicly obvious assistance, like legal defense for accused terrorists, and people who offer undercover support, like a prisoned official who helps a convicted terrorist, or a university faculty member who helps recruit people to the organization. The largest piece, the base of this pyramid, is made up of people who provide passive support. The people in the passive support group are not terrorists. While they may share some objectives with the terrorists, they don't directly support illegal acts. Some legitimate groups unwittingly provide a cover or facilities that are useful to terrorists. For example, a church-sponsored organization that helps impoverished immigrants may provide a job for someone who is really in the active cadre of the terrorist organization. The job gives the person a legitimate reason to meet with all kinds of people. It gives him access to equipment on which he can produce and reproduce leaflets and plans. It may even give him an opportunity to divert money contributed by well-meaning, upstanding citizens. More and more, groups seem to be sharing what they've learned about police capabilities and about terrorist tactics that have been successful. Some terrorists have even published manuals for making explosives, which you can buy almost as easily as you can get a cookbook. You can buy a theoretical justification and a kind of how to start your own terrorist group manual. One of the traditional means of raising money for terrorist activity has been robbing banks. Another has been kidnapping for ransom. But when the governments of sovereign nations support terrorism, it raises the problem to a new level. Terrorists need more than just money. They need weapons. These are just a few of the kinds of weapons that have been seized by the Treasury Department, the federal agency with jurisdiction over illegal weapons traffic. A campaign of violence or a credible threat of violence requires weapons. A terrorist group can usually find a local source of weapons. They steal them from police, and they steal them from military sources. But the more sophisticated the weapons, the harder they are to get without some sort of clandestine but official assistance. And it's almost essential to have state support to learn to use a weapon like this rocket launcher. State-supported training is a very important feature of international terrorism. An extreme example of an incident that required state support is the truck bomb that demolished the Marine barracks in Beirut. People don't learn to build such devices by tinkering around in the basement with materials from the hardware store. This level of sophistication, this quantity of explosive material, requires state support. When there is state support, there is an obvious opening for state direction. When we can identify a source of support for a terrorist action, or when we find evidence of state direction, it helps us to anticipate what might happen next and to determine what kind of response is appropriate. In the case of the bombing of the Berlin disco, La Belle Club, in April 1986, our intelligence showed definite evidence of support and direction from Libya. Some people call terrorism a weapon of the weak against the strong. For Libya to anonymously bomb a club popular with U.S. servicemen in a European country undoubtedly appeared to be a low-risk operation. Of course, they didn't expect to get caught. Let's look at the relationship between risk, the level of or intensity of violence, and the probability of occurrence in terrorism. Tactics with the lowest level of violence, tactics that can be carried out by an individual or a small group using handguns or small bombs, for example, against the softest targets, are the most frequent and therefore the most probable. An attack on a hard target with high-level violence takes professional organization and sophisticated resources. It involves more risk to the perpetrator, so fortunately, it is the least likely. What can we do to protect ourselves? The first thing is to get past the idea that terrorism is crazy and utterly unpredictable. Even though terrorism exploits the element of surprise, it is to some extent both understandable and predictable. It's important to get a grasp on just how terrorism works. To begin with, the dynamics of terrorism are expressed in a three-sided relationship. We're accustomed to thinking of the conflict between the government with its police and military forces on one side and the terrorists on the other. But it's useful to remember that this is an equilateral triangle. A key role is played by the victim, who is generally an individual or a small group. The terrorist attack is not directly on the government, but on a victim. Even when military or police forces are attacked, the importance of the victim is symbolic, not strategic. Against the victim, the terrorist uses violence or the threat of violence. The victims and the broader public respond to the terrorists with fear. In a hijacking, the hijacked passengers are the victims, and naturally, they are frightened. But so is everybody who is about to board other planes.
I am afraid for the people that are still on the plane.
When we was in Algeria, the bombs were being put on the plane and wired. That's when you sit and talk to your son, how great he loves you, and how much you love him.
The terrorist demands are not made of the victims, but of the government. When this is effective, it is because of the relationship between the victims and the government.
I beg you, Mr. President, I am terrified. I want him home, and I would like you to do it now.
When threatened this way, the victim's relationship with their government is one of dependence. And an essential part of any government's reason for being is the protection that it offers its citizens. Force, or the threat of force, is the government's means of influencing terrorist behavior towards their victims and of deterring incidents. There is a fourth party without which the terrorist dynamic would not work, the news media. Media coverage makes the victim's fear widely known, and it causes that fear to assume a very large influence on the government. Media coverage makes even the most far-fetched demands seem serious to the victims, or by extension, to the public. When West German commandos secured the release of passengers from the hijacked Lufthansa airliner, the media made it a triumph against terrorism. The Red Army faction suffered a setback in the public's estimation of its power. In contrast, when an Egyptian counterforce action against the hijackers of EgyptAir Flight 648 in 1985 resulted in the death of nearly 60 people, media coverage made it appear to be a test of the government's competence and its legitimacy. Media coverage of counterforce measures, especially when they don't succeed with surgical efficiency, can make the government's use of counterforce seem to be an overreaction. In the EgyptAir case, the terrorist agenda within the Arab world was served by making the Egyptian government seem both incompetent and disloyal to the Palestinian cause. Media coverage of terrorist incidents is critical to their impact on public opinion. But there's another way that media coverage serves the terrorists. Detailed reports of incidents enable groups to learn from the mistakes of other groups and to develop more efficient tactics. For example, in 1979, terrorists attempted to ambush General Haig with a culvert bomb and failed only because their timing was off by a few seconds. The general's car was unharmed, but the follow-up car was severely damaged. The general got out of his car to check up on the guards in the damaged car. The attackers were unprepared for this second opportunity. Instead of shooting the general, they ran away. Following that attack, when intelligence predicted an attack on General Croson, the German police requested that he use an armored car. To the terrorists, that was predictable, and they equipped themselves with a grenade launcher, which is capable of overpowering armor. But they also prepared a follow-up attack with small arms should the primary tactic fail. The triangle diagram is useful in understanding the three-way relationship that is the basis of every terrorist action. It can, however, leave the impression that the government is limited to very high-risk counterforce measures in responding to terrorism, and that the advantages all lie with the terrorists, and that's not entirely accurate. In the follow-up of the Achille Lauro hijacking, U.S. warplanes prevented the transport of the hijackers to asylum in Libya by forcing the plane down in Italy. That is an example of using superior intelligence, communications, and sophisticated military aircraft to capture terrorists. Now, let's quickly go through the basic tactics that terrorists have been using. The tactic of choice, the tactic most frequently used, is bombing. PIRA bombs in London or Lebanese bombs in Paris keep the terrorist issues before the public and keep the public frightened. Part of their effectiveness comes from their being so impersonal. To the competent perpetrator, the risk is not very great. The terrorist can place a bomb and be far away when it goes off. Remember, low risk means high probability. Ambush is a demanding tactic. It requires a coordinated team, careful preliminary surveillance. It requires vehicles. The attack on General Croson revealed evidence of careful surveillance, a military weapon, and a well-trained marksman. Ambush most commonly involves attacking someone who is traveling by car. In many respects, assassination is the simplest terrorist tactic. Unfortunately, this helps explain why it is also so common. Assassination is killing in a sudden and surprise attack. An instructive pair of assassination incidents began with the attempt on Christian Chapman, the chargé d'affaires at our embassy in Paris, who was attacked by a lone gunman in the street near Chapman's apartment. Chapman realized he was in danger, and he ducked behind a car, and the gunman missed him. A couple of months later, Lieutenant Colonel Charles Ray, the assistant military attaché at the embassy, was shot and killed by the same gun near his apartment. Neither of these men had armored cars or bodyguards. Neither was particularly prominent, but they were people who worked at the American embassy and lived and moved freely among the French population. It is a reminder that assassination is a tactic that can be directed at people who aren't particularly prominent. It's a low-risk proposition for the terrorist group. It usually exposes only one person and not for very long. It doesn't require complicated equipment. Assassination is sudden and brutal, and for these reasons, it can be very effective in undermining morale among groups that may feel targeted. One of the tactics most familiar to television viewers is aircraft hijacking or skyjacking. From beginning to end, a skyjacking gets full media attention, and the demands made by hijackers are billboarded to the world. If an American plane leaving a Greek airport is attacked by Palestinian terrorists based in Lebanon, who demand that the plane be taken to Libya or Iran, and they say that unless Kuwait releases some prisoners, they will kill the passengers, you have a thoroughly international incident on your hands. All these countries have a direct interest in the hijacking, and besides them, the government of the home country of every passenger on the plane, and every nation that has identified with the cause of the Palestinians, or that might be called on to offer asylum to the hostages. That's a lot of countries to consider in trying to negotiate a solution. A lot of countries that already have tense relations. Skyjackings have been carried out by some pretty ill-equipped teams, but for the most part, they demand good organization. It's a high-risk and high-profile operation. A skyjacking incident exposes the active cadre while it's going on and usually involves a request for safe conduct or asylum, which puts at least one government in the position of helping the terrorists. An exception to this is when Muslim extremists approach a skyjacking as a suicide mission. Like skyjacking, kidnapping is a human drama that draws continuing media attention. In Latin America, wealthy individuals and corporate executives have been held for ransom. Then the ransom finances further terrorist actions. Kidnappings in Latin America, Europe, and the Middle East have been used, like hijackings, to demand release of prisoners. A successful kidnapping operation is very demanding on the organization that carries it out. But if a terrorist group is well organized, a kidnapping can be a fairly safe tactic for them. Their chances of getting caught or killed are not very great. A hostage barricade action is a very high-risk tactic for a terrorist group because in a hostage barricade, everybody knows where you are. If the location is an embassy, at least two countries are involved. When the Turkish embassy is attacked in the Canadian capital, both the Turkish security forces and Canadian police are involved. Just as in a hijacking, the perpetrators need safe conduct and asylum in order to escape, which probably involves a third country. Robbery and extortion are largely fundraising operations for terrorist groups. They don't necessarily have any particular impact on public opinion, although left-wing groups may benefit from making banks appear vulnerable. One type of robbery is of particular concern to the military. Terrorists, robbers, don't always go after money. They steal weapons, they steal explosives, and they steal information. Information is a kind of weapon in the hands of an adversary, and extortion is a way of obtaining information. This brings us to an important area. The U.S. Armed Forces, including the Army, have been targeted by terrorist groups many times, especially in Europe. The famous bombing at the Rhein-Main Air Base was helped considerably by the murder of an American soldier whose ID papers were used to gain access to the base. Bombing the Frankfurt PX was obviously intended to intimidate families of the U.S. forces, and that is a very effective way to undermine overall morale. Kidnapping and ambushing American generals has had tremendous propaganda value and has forced many changes in travel and residential security. Most European terrorist groups oppose the alliance of Western democracies. They want to strain the NATO alliance and get the U.S. military out of Europe. They want to make NATO forces look like a liability. Under these circumstances, there's no reason to think that the Army will ever cease to be a target for terrorists. The question we all want to answer is, what can we do about terrorism? The U.S. and our allies have set up specialized military teams to respond to actual terrorist incidents. That concerns a limited number of people, and at best it helps contain damage once an incident has been initiated. Well-equipped counter-terrorist forces have sometimes shortened the duration of hostage barricade or hijack incidents, but they also raise the stakes or cause terrorists to set shorter deadlines if they think they are in immediate danger. Intelligence is one key to stopping events before they start. The Western countries have been cooperating better in order to interfere with the terrorists who threaten all of us. Prevention is better than trying to fix things after something has gone wrong. These manuals focus on what we can do to reduce the vulnerability of the force to terrorist attack. The key to prevention is to make it harder for a terrorist incident to be planned and carried out. Awareness means developing a security mindset. Act the way you would if you lived in a high-crime neighborhood. The steps are simple. Don't leave doors open when they should be closed. Don't leave sensitive documents exposed. Remember, to someone with malicious intent, information about where you're going and what you're doing might be interesting. Travel orders belong in a safe place, not lying around your hotel room when you're not there. And when you're traveling, it's wise to keep a low profile. Civilian clothes are less conspicuous than your uniform, and you can avoid well-known American hangouts. Lock your car. Then look it over before you unlock it and get in. Paying attention when things don't look right can pay off. Let me tell you a couple of stories that illustrate what I'm talking about. In the first example, a woman looked out her window and saw a van. She noticed some people in jogging suits coming and going. A little later, she saw that the people who had appeared to be joggers were standing by the van smoking cigarettes. It didn't add up. She called the police, and her tip led to the arrest of several leaders of a Puerto Rican terrorist organization. More important, police believe, on the basis of the weapons that they discovered, that they interrupted final preparations for a major incident in the U.S. The second example was in Germany. A German security guard saw a car drive onto the grounds of the NATO-shaped school. The man who got out of the car was dressed in a U.S. Marine uniform, but something didn't look quite right. The belt on his coat wasn't fastened properly, and there was something unfamiliar about the insignia on his hat. The guard continued to pay attention, and he saw the man walk off the grounds. That the man had driven up to the school and then left on foot was the final tip. The guard called the bomb squad. The car contained 55 pounds of dynamite, 3 butane cylinders, and bolts in a plastic pipe. In each case, a single alert individual interrupted a chain of events that might otherwise have led to injuries, deaths, property damage, and the impact on public opinion that terrorists seek. Most attacks are preceded by surveillance or by reconnaissance visits. Everybody has eyes and ears that can extend the reach of the security forces. For an intruder to be checked out by someone who works there shows him or her that they have been noticed and that access to the facility is not necessarily simple. An out-of-place object, like an abandoned briefcase, can be ignored or somebody can respond. We can have the greatest impact with a consistent application of simple steps. We've said that most terrorist actions are cheap for their sponsors. We want to introduce some inflation to raise the price to them. There's a role in this for every member of the armed forces, for their families, and for civilian employees. The first step in countering terrorism is recognizing that it is a real threat. Your vulnerability goes up and down depending on where you are and what's going on. Your level of alertness can be flexible in response to these changing circumstances. From beginning to end, the key is awareness. With awareness, you can make a difference to the safety of the armed forces and yourself.
Thank you.
Jim Hartz. You know, for the last decade or so, we've seen hundreds of stories in the newspapers and on television about terrorism attacks. The United States and other Western democracies have been targeted in most of these terrorist incidents. We've seen terrorist actions in the United States, in Latin America, in Europe, and in the Middle East. There have been skyjackings, bombings, assassinations, hostage barricade incidents, and kidnappings. There's no end in sight for terrorist activity, and unfortunately, because a conventional military response is usually not practical, people often think there is nothing we can do. Terrorism, as we understand it today, only seems to be wild and unpredictable. However, most terrorists act in ways that are goal-oriented and that can, to one degree or another, be predicted. As a way of helping to understand what we can do, we are going to take a look, a systematic look, at the trends in terrorist events through roughly the past decade. We'll look at the evolution in the tactics that they use, who they attack, and the kind of devices that they use. We're going to look at the kinds of people who become involved in terrorism and the causes they seek to advance through their actions. We will look at the development of terrorist groups' organizational systems, their leadership, and their support. And finally, we'll look at our own changing ability to respond to the terrorist challenge. Bombing has been and remains the most frequently used tactic. Bombs are used against facilities, and they can be used with horrible effectiveness against people. Let's look at the car bomb. During the past decade, we've seen a dramatic evolution in the car bomb. The car is useful because it conceals and transports a substantial quantity of explosive material. At Rhein-Main Air Base in Frankfurt, a car loaded with explosives was driven onto the base using stolen military ID. The explosion killed two people and did hundreds of thousands of dollars of damage to surrounding cars and buildings. Other kinds of bombs have been important and other schemes for delivering them. But insofar as there has been a trend, it is to larger and larger vehicle bombs. From the Rhein-Main case, with explosives packed into propane cylinders and delivered in a small Volkswagen, we move to the other extreme. This building housed the Marines who were serving in the multinational peacekeeping force in Beirut, along with French and Italian troops. With a truck loaded with gas-enhanced plastic explosives, terrorists leveled the concrete building, killing 241 Marines. Analysts said later that even if the truck had been stopped more than 100 feet from the building, it would have caused severe damage to the building and would have resulted in injuries and loss of life within the building. This is high technology of the most professional sort. For a long time, the car bomb was the tactic of choice in the Middle East. But recently, kidnapping has emerged as a frequently employed tactic against Western targets. Political conflict and civil disorder in the Middle East have made it possible for groups to seize and hold hostages for long periods without much threat of challenge from civil authorities. Islamic radicals in the Middle East have targeted Americans as well as Western Europeans in Beirut and elsewhere. In Europe, we can see a change from the 1970s when left-wing terrorists kidnapped and sometimes killed local business and political leaders, to the targeting of NATO officials and U.S. military figures. We've had vehicle attacks against General Alexander Haig in Belgium and against General Frederick Crosen in Germany. And General James Dozier was kidnapped by the Red Brigades in Italy. Targeting U.S. and NATO officials can be considered a significant trend. But as far as the kidnapping tactic goes, the Italian police success in freeing General Dozier in 1982 illustrates how risky a kidnapping can be for the perpetrators where effective civil authority and efficient police are in place. Insurgent groups in Latin America have continued to use kidnapping either to collect ransom from international corporations or to secure concessions from the civil authorities. Some analysts associate kidnapping with the first stage of an insurgency effort. Media exploitation is a common feature of terrorist actions. One tactic that has a special connection to the age of television is aircraft hijacking. In the 1960s, homesick refugees from Castro's Cuban Revolution commandeered commercial airplanes and demanded to be taken to Havana. The Cuban government welcomed them and took advantage of the publicity. The Cuban skyjackings illustrated how vulnerable commercial airliners were to armed takeover. They also showed the importance of safe conduct or asylum granted by the government where the plane puts down. When Castro began treating skyjackers as criminals, skyjackings to Cuba practically stopped. In the 1980s, turmoil in the Middle East provided the motive and the opportunity for some dramatic skyjackings. When Islamic extremists took control of a TWA airliner bound from Athens to Rome, a world audience kept up with the unfolding events.
He has pulled a hand grenade, Ted, and he is ready to blow up the aircraft if he has to. We must, I repeat, we must land at Beirut. We must land at Beirut. No alternatives.
Islamic extremists demanded the release of prisoners held in various countries. They killed an American Navy diver and threatened the lives of other Americans and of Israeli passengers.
They are beating the passengers. They are beating the passengers. They are threatening to kill them now. They are threatening to kill them now. We want the fuel now, immediately.
Flight 847 showed all too clearly that conditions like those in Lebanon at the time made it possible to take hostages off the plane and hold them in several different locations, like kidnap victims, while continuing to hold the plane and crew. Anti-terrorist action against any single location would jeopardize the safety of other hostages elsewhere. Counter-terrorist forces have achieved a few spectacular rescues, but when Egyptian special forces attempted to rescue passengers on a hijacked EgyptAir flight, the resulting bloodbath was a harsh reminder that rescue attempts involve great risk. All skyjackings in the last few years illustrate that despite security systems, dedicated terrorists have been able to find a way around them. And the existence of counter-terrorist forces has provoked terrorists to set shorter deadlines, knowing that their control of the situation is not absolute. Where counter-terrorist forces have had a clearly positive impact is in hostage barricade incidents. After 1980, hostage barricade incidents began to decline in frequency. That's good news, but the bad news is that kidnappings and skyjackings increased somewhat. This suggests that terrorists have simply chosen a different tactic in response to our increasing the cost or difficulty of the hostage barricade. The ambush tactic provides an example of another terrorist response to improved security measures. As protection for U.S. officers has been strengthened, terrorists have acquired the means to overcome them. General Croson in Heidelberg had guards at his house, an armored car with an armed aide, and a follow car with more armed guards. The ambush team had performed thorough surveillance. They lay in wait for several days at the ambush site, and they used a Soviet rocket launcher with great skill. As these scenes indicate, armor plating does not provide absolute protection against a rocket-launched grenade. Those are the basic tactics that terrorists use. The tactics, the targets, and the technology used by terrorists have been changing, in part because of what we've been doing to counteract them. Well, what trends can we foresee? Bombing is likely to remain the most popular tactic overall. Bombing is cheap. Technology is on the side of the bomber. Chemical and plastic explosives are hard to detect in transit, and they concentrate a lot of power. Microchips make possible extremely long time delays for detonators. Ambush will continue to be an effective way to attack important and well-protected individuals. Kidnapping is a tactic that may be discouraged by effective police work. Hostage barricade incidents, too, are risky for terrorists any place where police work is good. But there are many parts of the world where we can't count on this. The problem of skyjacking may prove responsive to increased efforts at international cooperation. Concerted policies and actions by governments can produce more reliable airport security and better cooperation if an incident does occur, improving chances for a satisfactory resolution. Prevention is always the most desirable approach, but it becomes even more important when we consider the threat posed by terrorists whose religious convictions make them unafraid of death or even cause them to seek death. In the 1980s, the rise of Shiite Muslim fundamentalism in the Middle East has presented just this problem. Shiite extremism encourages its people to be willing to die in what they view as a holy war. Many Shiite extremists have a persistent idea that America is a diabolical influence that has to be driven out. To them, any attack on the United States is a way of winning favor with God. There's no reason to expect the U.S. will cease to be targeted by terrorist groups. We are a large and influential nation. A successful attack on any symbol of our power confers a degree of importance on the attacking organization, no matter how small it is. Well, what about terrorism at home in the United States? Do we have anything to worry about here? We tend to think about domestic terrorism as a problem of the late 60s and early 70s, and to some extent that's true. The civil rights movement and the protests against the Vietnam War, which were legal, constitutionally protected protest movements, spun off some fringe groups that engaged in domestic terrorism. Some of these activities have continued, but domestic left-wing extremism today seems more related to international agendas. For example, corporate offices have been bombed by terrorists who say they are protesting the corporation's roles in South Africa. Puerto Rican nationalist groups have been active both within Puerto Rico and the continental United States. Some of them are in contact with anti-American groups in Latin America. A domestic problem that seems to have grown more serious comes from right-wing groups. These include tax resistance organizations that target government officials and any police other than county sheriffs, racial supremacy groups who target minority group members, and groups that combine elements of both these tendencies. Many of these groups tend to have a fascination with explosives and firearms. This house contained an arsenal belonging to a group called The Order. The arsenal exploded during a shootout between the group's founder and the FBI. Right-wing groups sometimes seem to welcome confrontation with the police, and officers have been killed trying to make arrests. In the United States, we value freedom of movement, freedom from search and seizure, and freedom to espouse unpopular ideas. This freedom and the openness of our political process have meant that terrorist activity in this country has never gained a broad base of support. People often raise questions about the potential for superviolence. Our economy relies on lots of things that carry hazards. There is a potential for terrorist actions with very large-scale casualties. But several analysts have suggested that large-scale casualties are not consistent with terrorist objectives, that they would provoke public outrage and they would justify severe retaliatory measures. What kind of people become terrorists? True terrorists usually have some political, religious, or ideological motives. They really believe that capitalism is evil or that the United States represents the forces of evil. They may seek a national homeland. They may be starting a genuine revolution. They have a crusading spirit. They want to get wider attention or respect for their ideas. Some terrorists might be obsessed, might have a distorted view of their grievances and how to resolve them. If we dismiss them as crazies, it can lead us to think of terrorists' actions as unpredictable or purposeless, and that isn't true. Most terrorists serve identifiable causes and pursue their objectives systematically. Most terrorists belong to groups that have identifiable agendas. And, in the last decade, we've seen a trend toward linkages between groups and across national boundaries. After the Rhein-Main Air Base bombing, the German Red Army faction and the French group Direct Action claimed to have cooperated in the attack. Both groups share an anti-NATO, anti-capitalist, anti-democratic agenda. Police analysts believe that the Red Army faction actually carried out the attack, but that the French group cooperated by furnishing safe houses and possibly some intelligence. The attack on Le Bel Club, the bar in Berlin that was a popular spot with American soldiers, and the series of bombings by Lebanese terrorists in Paris in the fall of 1986 illustrate two other developments: state-supported terrorism and state-directed terrorism. Libya has often been identified as a supporter with money, materiel, training, or asylum, but the Le Bel Club bombing in Berlin was directed by Libya. In Paris, the bombings appeared to have been carried out by a Lebanese group that was seeking the release of George Abdullah, a Lebanese Christian who was in a French jail awaiting trial in connection with the assassination of U.S. Lieutenant Colonel Charles Ray. The Lebanese Armed Revolutionary Faction has some connection with the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine, which receives support from sovereign states in the Arab world. The truck bomb used against the Marine barracks in Lebanon could not have been assembled by a group without both state support and the cover of civil turmoil. The technology was sophisticated and the materiel was not homemade. Furthermore, it was such a quantity that it would be very difficult to smuggle across a secure border or assemble in a nation with any degree of civil order and effective police forces. State support can take the form of providing weapons or explosives that can be transported through diplomatic channels in clear violation of internationally accepted practice. State support can include furnishing intelligence to terrorists. Another obvious form of support is money. Some small countries that are not particularly strong have tremendous oil revenues and have used that money to support terrorist actions elsewhere. Money now can buy the services of the terrorist who operates as a professional, bargaining for training and for support from various sponsors. When the sponsor is a state, the sponsor can arrange for an attack that injures the United States without undertaking an open act of war. It can be difficult to pinpoint responsibility for that attack. Cooperation between states is one key to defeating state-supported terrorism. After the attack on the nightclub in Berlin, the U.S. government presented clear, intelligence-based evidence of support and direction from Libya and other evidence indicating Libyan abuse of diplomatic privileges in European capitals. The response was a greater degree of cooperation among the Western democracies in opposing terrorism. Each country is understandably sensitive about its intelligence resources, and it's not simple for even the friendliest nations to cooperate in this area. But recognition of a common threat has been a strong incentive for police to cooperate. To help us deal with the question of what we can do about terrorism, we gathered in the studio a panel of people with special backgrounds in understanding and responding to terrorism. We have three experts on our subject today. Welcome, gentlemen. Oliver Revelle is FBI Executive Assistant Director for Investigations. Since 1985, Mr. Revelle has been the Director's Principal Deputy for Investigative, Counterterrorist, and Intelligence Activities. He serves on the National Security Council's Terrorist Crisis Management Committee. James Stenson is a terrorism and unconventional warfare specialist. Jim is knowledgeable about the Army's counterterrorism work and has been a frequent lecturer at the Command and General Staff College at Fort Leavenworth and at a seminar program for senior officers at Fort McClellan. During his military service, he was a team member of the U.S. Army Special Forces Airborne. Our third guest is David Dixon. Early in 1987, Mr. Dixon retired as deputy commander of New Scotland Yard's anti-terrorist branch. He was directly involved in investigations of several major incidents, including the siege at the Libyan embassy in London, the IRA bombing in Brighton, and the attempt to bomb an El Al airliner. Since retiring, Mr. Dixon has been lecturing and consulting on terrorism and terrorism-related security to government agencies and corporations. I'd like to begin with a sort of a general question for everybody. I think there's a perception among a lot of people, both civilians and in the armed forces, that here we are, the United States, perhaps the most powerful military country in the world, and the United Kingdom with similar forces. Why is it that we can't stop this terrorism problem that seems to be only perhaps a few hundred people in the world? And if that is not true, are we making progress in controlling it? Buck, would you like to begin?
Well, Jim, I think we are making progress. I think the most dramatic progress has been on the domestic scene, where we have largely diminished the acts of terrorists to virtually zero. Doesn't mean that it cannot reoccur. Internationally, it's much more complex. You're dealing with both political and cultural and economic conditions that are largely out of the control of any one country or group of countries. But progress is being made in that we're seeing additional cooperation between military, intelligence, and law enforcement agencies on the international level.
Mm-hmm. David, would you echo that from across the Atlantic?
What I'd like to say, the words international terrorist or international terrorism, I would say strongly requires an international response. That is paramount. We in England, and I can speak for Europe, we have been hit. We have been maimed. We come back, we debrief, and we say, learn something from that. But the frustration comes when the hunt is on and you chase the terrorist, you're frustrated by countries that are prepared to give them refuge.
From somewhat of an academic point of view, Jim, what's your view? Are we making progress against people who willfully commit acts of murder and violence for political ends or for their own ends?
The difficulty is that, and from a research standpoint, and just looking at the numbers, we're seeing the number of incidents increase across the board, and we expect that to continue for some years to come. Mm-hmm. But our focus and response has been on the incident, and what we're finding is that there's a great deal of success being conducted by various governments when they focus on the pre-incident activities, on the entity that creates the attack, as compared to waiting until the incident occurs and then responding to it, in which case it's going to be a part of history forever. Mm-hmm. It's a much more viable solution and approach to deal with the problem before it begins, but it's a very complex intelligence and operations problem.
Mm-hmm. David, let me ask you this. Is it a police problem now? Is terrorism being considered a criminal act rather than perhaps a political statement?
Well, in England, we looked at it always as a criminal act. And of course, can I just say the terrorist? We look at the terrorist. Bear this in mind, that he is a member of a very sophisticated, highly professional unit, military unit, who carries out a war. And in Europe, and no doubt in other parts of the world, what do we put up against this man? We put up against him the domestic police force. That is a tall order. Mm-hmm. Certainly in England, where we were unarmed, and we saw fit, certainly round about the 1970s, to put together an anti-terrorist branch, or squad, to deal with the terrorists who was coming in. They came in the form of the Irish, and the Arabs, and Sikhs. And we took them on, and we feel very much that we're beating them at their own game.
What it's required is that police organizations have to expand in the area of intelligence and operations to where they start to take on a similar type of tactical approach from collection and analysis as military organizations. And the military organizations, on the other hand, have to become more like police organizations, because the groups that we see operating worldwide operate in the shadows, in the cracks, and it makes it a very complex investigation, very long term.
Mm-hmm. Buck, let me ask you to elaborate a little bit on what the FBI has been able to do in recent years. I think it probably is the general impression that the FBI is a domestic investigative and police organization, but now you're saying that you have the power to move into the international arena. Would you define what the FBI's role is now specifically? What can you do, and with whom can you cooperate?
All right, well, we cooperate through a number of different apparatus, the Interpol, International Criminal Police Organization, through other groups such as the Trevi Organization and amongst the European common market countries. What we can do is conduct investigations worldwide against acts that are committed against American citizens by terrorist groups. If we can identify those who have committed the acts, we can bring charges in the United States. A recent example was the arrest of Fawaz Yunus, a Shia Muslim terrorist from Beirut, who had hijacked with a crew of other Shia an Air Jordan flight on which four Americans were held hostage. We arrested him in an international operation off the coast of Cyprus and brought him back to the United States for trial. There are several other examples where we have had other governments, the German government, arrest a fellow by the name of Muhammad Ali Hamadi, who was one of the principals involved in the TWA hijacking, 847. They arrested him on the basis of our investigation and our charges. Together, law enforcement agencies are learning to work in this arena. We've worked with the British police, Scotland Yard, and British authorities for years on dealing with Irish terrorists. In that regard, I think we are doing exactly what Jim said. We are looking at the organization, we're looking at the trends and the methods of operation to preempt and interdict their activities rather than just wait for them to occur.
Mm-hmm. We've said that there's a sort of a growing professionalism and sophistication among terrorist groups. Are we dealing now with a different sort of terrorist, perhaps not a fanatic, perhaps not an ideologue, but a true professional hitman, so to speak? David, from the point of view of the United Kingdom?
You see, gone are the days where the man comes in the black cloak with that fizzing bomb and puts it down. You won't get that. He comes in, a very clinical, professional unit, does his deed and out he goes. And certainly we identified that in the bombing at Brighton when they tried to kill Mrs. Thatcher. There was an operation carried out, all right, by the IRA, but the sophistication of that weapon, that bomb that had been put into that building some 2-4 weeks beforehand, timed to go when she was finished her speech to retire to her room, and of course it went off at 2 o'clock in the morning, killing 3 people, maiming many others.
Barely missing.
Very sophisticated.
Jim, I'd like to turn to you now, and from a research point of view, are we really seeing international cooperation between these groups, do you think?
Since we began keeping accurate statistics back in the 1970s, one of the trends that's been quite disturbing is the fact that the groups are starting to communicate more with each other, exchanging personnel, training, equipment, supplies. These kinds of relationships that did not exist in the 70s are becoming more a routine course of events in the 80s. And one of the other trends that's particularly disturbing is that a number of the groups are developing techniques to counter our counterforce teams, which is going to make a major impact on the way we deal with the problem in the future.
That brings up a question. You mentioned the term trends, which is what we want to address here. Where are we going? Is the, Buck, is the type of terrorism changing as our tactics change to counter it? And what are we going to see in the future, do you think? Peer into your crystal ball for a moment.
The situation in Lebanon is obviously generating terrorism with the, particularly the Hezbollah, the very radical Shia supporters of the Ayatollah Khomeini. Mm-hmm. We have other areas of the world where terrorism is also being generated by a number of factors. I think one of the most troublesome areas for the United States in the future may be South America. Colombia has had terrorist problems for some time, the FARC, M19 group, but we now see in Peru the Sendero Luminoso becoming very sophisticated and very much involved in anti-capitalist, anti-Western type of terrorist activities, including targeting American interests, American facilities. Terrorism is not going to go away. It is a very successful tactic, and virtually no type of crime leaves us. We may control it, we may contain it if we put our minds and efforts to it, but we do not dissolve the ongoing activities. So I think our primary purpose is to make sure that those that are potential targets are educated and informed and trained, and that we have concerted action and cooperative international response to control and contain it to the greatest degree possible.
David, I'm going to give Scotland Yard the last word here.
Well, what Buck has said, I agree. The terrorist, he has generally got the trump card. He can call the churn. And I always remember just after the Brighton bomb again, we were right in the midst of the investigation, and we got a message from the terrorist group, from the IRA. And they said, and they're very operative words these, they said, you have to be successful all the time. We only have to be successful once.
Thank you, gentlemen. You will notice that no one here has projected a trend toward fewer incidents or to a diminished importance of terrorism as a form of conflict. So long as it is a threat, we will need to be vigorous in monitoring the trends, in working to intervene and prevent incidents, in reducing the vulnerability of the force, and in having the right resources at hand when incidents do occur. Thank you, Jess Gray.